Let's have a big round of applause for Mary.
Thank you very much, Mary. Appreciate this very much and appreciate the opportunity to connect with you folks. I'm going to go through as a solution to this problem, and we need to work together to drive our governments to assist and make that happen. I don't think I need to spend a lot of time talking about the impacts. I think you all know what's happening right now on our waterfronts. I've got some pictures here that are from Brian Rambler. I'm not sure where Brian is right now. There he is down the back. He's a local marine operator. He's been extremely helpful over the years in getting media, including television cameras, out on the shore to see what's happened and to talk to local residents about what the impacts are. So you know what these high and dry docks mean. This is the bay that Brian took me to, that CTV Barry did a program on, part of their news. This bay is basically dried up, and all of the property owners around this bay no longer really are on the waterfront. And what is the impact for them? Will they come back to their cottages in the summertime? And what is the impact for fish, for the wildlife that used to use that bay? Brian also provided this to me, and you can see here, this is looking inland towards what used to be a boathouse and a dock, and then when he turned the camera and looked out, this is how far away the water is now from that boathouse. I don't know how many of you attended the IJC's public hearing in Midland last summer. There were well over 600 people in attendance at that meeting, far more than at any of the other public meetings that they held around the Great Lakes. The commissioners heard it loud and clear, restore our water levels. But given what their action is right now, the question is, did it really hear? And the reality is, unfortunately, that the impact for the sustainable water levels for Georgian Bay are probably more significant than they are for all of Lake Huron and Lake Michigan. And that's kind of an unfortunate scenario. It's because of our complex coastline and the gradient from land into the water. Whenever that's a low gradient, i.e. low slope, the impact is greater. So I'm going to get into some of the technical issues here, but if you've got any questions, put up your hand. I don't want to get bogged down in anything else than the slide that's up on the screen. And then at the end, we can have questions of a more general nature. Is that okay with everyone? Okay, this is the current water level situation. Just so you know, this is from the U.S. Army Corps. This is from the 28th of February, 2013. So the red line is last year's water levels. The blue line here is where the water levels is right now. So this is Lake Michigan here on Georgian Bay. This is Lake Superior, Lake St. Clair, Lake Erie, Lake Ontario. So you can see how far away we are from the level that we were at last year at this time. And these gray dots, this is important. This is the long-term average for each of the Great Lakes. So again, you can see how far away we are from our long-term average compared to the other Great Lakes. Lake Superior is down, but nowhere as far low, below the long-term average as we are. Lake Erie is obviously, it's around 10 inches. Lake Ontario is very close to its long-term average. We are now 29 inches below our long-term average. And what is significant is that we have been hovering close to this level now for 14 years. This was in the Detroit News not that long ago, just graphically showing you what I just described to you. And Lake Ontario has come up since then. The recent storms have helped to raise Lake Ontario levels, but they have done nothing. They haven't come as far north, some of them, so we have not had the benefit of that precipitation. This graph is complicated, and I'm happy to go back to it later if you want me to. This is the long-term water levels for all of the Great Lakes from 1865 to, and it's brought right up to date, to 2012. So this black line is the overall trend line for each of the Great Lakes. You can see Lake Superior trend line is barely inching up. But here, back in 1977, they put a new plan in place for the control gates at the outflow of Lake Huron, of Lake Superior. And since then, they have been required to try to address low water level conditions downstream. And by doing that, they are now drawing down Lake Superior. That's the overall trend line since 1977. This is irresponsible. That is the headwaters of the Great Lakes. And now those control gates should be maintained for the interests of Lake Superior. They should not be drawing it down to try and address low water level conditions here. So you can see this huge variability that we've had on Lakes Michigan, Huron, and Georgian Bay. And we have been down this low before in the 1930s and in the 1960s. We are right back down there now. In the 1930s, this is when they carried out the most significant dredging in the St. Clair River. They dredged from 20 feet to 25 feet. And here in the early 1960s, they dredged then to 27 and a half feet deep. What's interesting here is partway through that dredging operation, they were blasting the Detroit River. In order to do it then, they blocked off half the river to dry up the riverbed so they could blast it more easily. And in doing that, look what they did to water levels on Michigan and Huron. That makes it pretty clear what could happen if you reduce the output. Lake Erie has been the beneficiary of this increased supply and has a gradually increasing trend line. Lake Ontario was heavily regulated, mostly in the interests of hydropower. It has a very narrow range fluctuation. We have a 6.5 foot range. They have about a 4 foot range. Fluctuation is good. It's good for, particularly for wetlands. It helps to increase diversity of the plants and open up areas for fish to be able to move in and out of wetlands to spawn. Wetlands are needed by 80% of Great Lakes fish for spawning in nursery habitat. We right now have lost about 30% of wetland habitat on Georgian Bay, probably the highest quality wetlands found anywhere in the Great Lakes. And in many areas now that I have visited over the past 14 years, in many areas, we now have phragmites taking over shorelines and invasive reed. In other areas, we have 5-6 foot tall pine trees growing where once there were wetlands. A loss of even 10% is considered very significant, but to have lost 30% is very, very concerning. This just graphically tells you what the impact is of the changes in the navigation channels that have been carried out over the years. And you can see how impacted Lake Michigan Huron is. This is actually from the International Joint Commission interim report in 1999. They haven't used that since then because our water levels have been so low. But here we have, because of navigation dredging, a loss of almost 20 inches from Michigan and Huron. This does not take into consideration the erosion that has happened since that dredging took place. So the number is even higher than that. This is egregious, and I will get into this later some more. This is the St. Clair River. This is Sarnia on the left side, Port Huron on the right side. This is the Blue Water Bridge, basically the most heavily altered connecting channel in the Great Lakes. When the Seaway was designed, they designed locks and control gates for the St. Clair River. They didn't do that project, and here we have basically very hardened shorelines on the U.S. side. This is a steel wall that goes straight down. That forces this, you can't really sense the flow of the river here. It's around 7 knots. But as it goes into the river, it hits this steel wall and has no other choice but to dig down and to scour out as it moves down the river. So basically the width, the depth, the amount of sand flowing, sand and clay flowing with the water, determines how fast this flows. This riverbed has been mined for sand and gravel. I'll get to that in a minute. And many dredging projects have taken place. This cross-section is just south of that Blue Water Bridge. This is what the profile looked like in 1971. And by 2000, this is what had happened. This is on the US side. This is where the flow was the fastest. Here we have this significant increase. This is 12 meters deep here. This is what ships need for navigation. They don't need anywhere near this depth. And we move down to 18 meters deep here. This is the St. Clair River bathymetry, the depth profile. So here we have Sarnia again on this side, Port Huron here. The bridge goes across about here. Across the mouth of the river, there used to be a natural sand and gravel walk that acted as a natural weir to restrict that outflow. But way back around 1900 to 1920, they mined this area for sand and gravel. And they took it ashore with teams of horses on great big sleds, and they used the sand and gravel for construction purposes in Sarnia. They then cut through this for navigation, and they cut through it many times. So basically, they opened up the gates, and they have never provided the compensation that they were required to place to address this, these changes.
When you say they,
The dredging was taking place under agreement between Canada and the United States.
Ontario agreed with that.
Ontario agreed with that, absolutely, yeah. Yeah. The sand and gravel mining, though, unfortunately happened early enough that nobody considered the impact of that. I'm not going to go through this long list, but this basically tells you the history of all of the changes that have taken place in the St. Clair River. And it points out that here back in 1972, compensation structures were designed. They built an actual physical model. The U.S. Army Corps built the sills, the submerged sills, for the foundations for the submerged sills. Canada bickered for 10 years with the U.S. over the hydraulic impact of those submerged sills. And eventually the funding was withdrawn for the project by U.S. Senate. But that agreement and the authorization for that, the U.S. Army Corps has recently informed us, is still valid. It was never withdrawn. And the compensation structures that were designed then, that was a condition of doing the dredging that took place in 1960-62. So this year we've got in 2004, our team of engineers worked on this and found that there was erosion taking place in the St. Clair River, brought it to the attention of the International Joint Commission. The International Upper Great Lake Study concluded in 2009 and recommended doing nothing to remediate the St. Clair River. We submitted comments pointing out to them that they are missing 200 cubic meters per second flow in all of their work. They said they would get back to us. They have never replied. We also pointed out others' errors to them. They have never responded. So basically, now 2012, you heard what happened last summer, but now the International Joint Commission, in a meeting in Chicago, announced that they are going to be recommending this new Great Lakes Regional Adaptive Management Plan. And I don't know if you know what that means, but in our minds, it means doing nothing, get used to it, folks. This is the way it's going to be. They also said at that meeting that the water levels will be on the lower side in the future due to climate change effects, but still will stay within their long-term historic average. We've got this downward trend line. It's not happening to the other Great Lakes, but also we have just recently set new record lows, both for the month of December and January. So how they can say that is unconscionable. So at the bottom, I'm saying what we need is our Canadian government, particularly Foreign Affairs Minister Baird, to work with the U.S. government. Kerry, who's just been appointed in the U.S. by Obama, and request that we honor the 1956 agreement and provide funding to the U.S. Army Corps for compensation sills in the St. Clair River. This is just showing you the years that we have met the IJC definition for crisis conditions. And you can see when we have been this low before, it was when navigation dredging took place. And here we have now 14 years of hovering around this level with no official changes, navigation changes in the St. Clair River. This is also from the IJC study, just so you know what their predictions are in terms of climate change. Here's the probability of high water levels going into the future. This is the regional climate change model where they took the global climate change model and brought it down to a Great Lakes level, because the Great Lakes create their own climate, as you likely know. So here we have less than 5% chance of having high water levels going into the future. And here we have over 85% of low water levels going into the future. Just based on this information alone, we need some ability to retain waters in this huge body of water, Michigan, Huron, and Georgian Bay. The other lakes have that ability. There are control gates for the outflow of Lake Superior and Lake Ontario. There are control gates in the Niagara River. We have nothing for this huge body of water. I just want you to know that part of the scheme that the Upper Lake Study carried out was to misrepresent and exaggerate their own model results of placing compensation measures in the St. Clair River. They did an incredible job of fear-mongering downstream interests. And this was the slide used during all of their public meetings, where they're showing what a 1 meter decline would do to Lake St. Clair. Their own model showed there would only be a 7.5 centimeter temporary decline. If you lived on Lake St. Clair, it's a shallow lake, the deepest part 15 feet deep. It has this 30-foot navigation channel dredged right through it. But if you lived on Lake St. Clair, you would be pretty upset if the water levels were lowered by a meter. We pointed this out to them before they even went to public meetings, and they said, oh, whoops-a-daisy, we'll get back to you, but they never did. They carried on with their public meetings and used this. So this is basically the result of their $17 million study. This was funded both by Canada and the United States. They provided no viable option for water level restoration, even though they were requested. The study was interrupted partway through. The commissioner said, please look at restoration, how water levels could be restored. They provide no viable option for that. But the reality is that it is possible to restore Michigan, Huron, Georgian Bay water levels gradually and responsibly in consideration of downstream conditions. The U.S. Army Corps have recently been in touch with us. They have authorization. Under our existing agreement, they only need funding to proceed. They've admitted they built the foundations, and they now want funding to review their past design, update approvals. They carried out an environmental impact study then. They want to update that, and we would agree with that. This needs to be done responsibly. So just so you know, this is the document that we unearthed. The study board knew about this, but they remain silent on this. This is a very significant document. It's actually legislation in the United States from the Senate. This is the language from that document. With regard to the effects of the project on water levels of the Great Lakes, detailed hydraulic studies have been undertaken and compensating works are included in the plan of improvement, which will assure that the lake levels will not be adversely affected. The fluctuation of the levels will remain the same as under the present conditions. In the St. Clair River, accomplishment of the presently authorized compensating works would offset the lowering effect of Lakes Michigan and Huron of both the proposed improvement 1962 and the previous dredging 1930s. That's incredible. That's going back a long way in time, and they're basically saying restore Michigan and Huron by almost.